Hello, fellow students of Jewish history. So one of the most important aspects of the development of early Ashkenaz is the remarkable attention that was devoted by these migrants to northern Germany to the construction of the social order of the Kehillah. The word Kehillah comes from the Hebrew root kaha, which means to gather together, to congregate. But it was a term that was used, synonymous with the term kahal, to refer to the social structure of the Jewish community in Ashkenaz and then beyond. And since they were basically like pioneers in this region to the far north of anywhere where Jews had ever settled before, they basically had to make these things up as they went along. Certainly they relied on earlier precedents that were set, for example, in the diaspora in Babylonia and elsewhere, but they didn't have, you know, these large moderating centralized institutions like the yeshivas in Sura and Pompadita that characterize the development of the Babylonian community. So they basically had to figure out, well, how are we going to organize ourselves? And this structure of the Kehillah was something that really got them through the next 1,000 years of diaspora in a very profound way and continued to affect the way that Jews organize themselves in the modern period. But before we approach the medieval understanding and the function of the Kehillah, we have to realize where we stand today in the 21st century. We now are, you know, 250 years out from the French Revolution, which marked a dramatic change in the structure of the Jewish community and the relationship of individual Jews, not only to their communal organization, but to the society beyond it. Let's just have a quick moment to look at France and understand what that change was so we can go back and try to understand what the Ashkenazic Kehillah really was like. So in 1789, one of the major changes of the French Revolution was, you know, a way of looking at the Jews who lived in France as actual French citizens rather than sort of like temporary residents, people who were passing through for hundreds of years, living in exile from Israel. How were they to be dealt with in this modern nation state? So it didn't happen right away. The revolution occurred in 1789, but the founding principles of that revolution basically argued for the equality of all citizens of France, at least all men, at least all white men. But that begged the question, were we going to consider French women as citizens? They said initially no. Were we to consider French Jews as citizens? And that took a little bit more debate, but basically in 1790, the French extended full emancipation to the Jews of Bordeaux and Bayonne, the Sephardic Jews who were living closer to the Spanish border. And that's largely because they were far more adapted to French culture. They were much more likely to be French speaking, to live in less tightly concentrated units, to have a broader demographic profile, especially an economic profile and so on. But the Jews of Alsace-Lorraine on the eastern border with Germany, they were a much harder case because they spoke Yiddish, they tended to dress very differently, they were Ashkenazic and so on. But after a year in 1791, they were also admitted. This resulted in a certain level of outcry from the non-Jewish populations of that region because all of the anti-Semitic regulations which had, you know, restrained Jewish economic activity in particular were lifted, and suddenly there was a rush of Jews into all parts of the economy that many other non-Jews felt threatened by. And so they appealed to Napoleon. Napoleon, in his characteristic way, said, well, you know, why don't we ask the Jews themselves what their intentions are here? What's the major deliberative body of the Jews? There must be some kind of like Pope or must be some sort of Vatican for the Jews. And his advisor said, well, there isn't, at least not in the last 1800 years since the Sanhedrin met. The Sanhedrin, of course, is the great court of the Jews that, you know, was destroyed with the Roman-Jewish wars. Napoleon, in his characteristic way, said, that doesn't matter anything to me. I'm Napoleon. Let us resurrect the Sanhedrin, and we'll have a representative body of the Jews of Europe, and they'll tell us, you know, how they really feel about citizenship. Are they going to be loyal to the state or not? This is a whole story we've spoken about in another video, so I won't go back to it now. But it was an amazing situation. Of course, the Sanhedrin, first called the Assembly of Jewish Notables, they knew exactly what Napoleon wanted to hear, and they gave him the answers to 12 questions that he posed. And he said, okay, after hearing these answers, I'm going to validate the situation of the Jews as citizens in France. More to say about the story, but if you have a look at this image, you get a sense of how Napoleon must have viewed it. Here he is, you know, and typically humble fashion, holding on to these tablets that say La Loi on them, and he's lifting up the fallen maiden who represents Judaism. There is a positively biblical kind of background. It looks like somehow the temple, and in the distance, the Judean desert and the menorah and things like that. The caption reads that Napoleon the Great rehabilitates the Jewish religion on the 30th of May, 1806. The Jews, for their part, although there were certain pockets of resistance who felt like this was very, very dangerous, and it would, in fact, be quite dangerous to the structure of the Kehillah, they basically welcomed this affirmation of emancipation, and they printed things like this remarkable medallion that celebrates Napoleon's gift of emancipation to the Jews. On the left, you see Napoleon's profile, and on the right, you see Napoleon, once again, not someone to fall for false humility. He's portrayed as God himself, presenting the two tablets of the law to a genuflecting Moses. Just incredible. At any rate, that's a major change. And what that means for the Kehillah is that ever since that moment, when Napoleon affirmed the decision of emancipation, basically Jews in modern states, it took about 100 years for the rest of Europe to come around, but Jews in modern states are equal citizens with everybody else, which means that the government deals with Jews as individuals, not as communities. It's not like the medieval period where the king didn't deal with people as individuals. He dealt with corporations. He dealt with the peasants as a whole, the nobility as a whole, the church as a whole. And it's a big change because now Jews have only a voluntary relationship to their communal affiliation. If they choose, they may simply abandon the community and assimilate, or simply choose not to affiliate without assimilating into the general body politic. Everything now becomes quite voluntary, as opposed to the medieval or pre-modern period where the Kehillah had actual coercive power, where it was an arm of the state, where the king had vested in the Kehillah, in the Jewish community, some authority to force Jews to actually behave according to its dictates. So that's kind of like the dark side of the Kehillah. On the one hand, it's quite coercive, and Jews were forced to essentially behave according to its dictates. This was a very salutary element of the Kehillah because it meant that it was very hard to assimilate. The only way to assimilate to the general population was to switch religions, to actually become a Christian. That's actually a very high bar, and so very few Jews were simply willing to leap over it. Only with modernity do we have large-scale assimilation, because it's possible to simply not affiliate with the community and float into a secular identity without necessarily converting. The Kehillah also had tremendous powers of taxation, and they could use the funds that they generated from the Kehillah to provide for a very extensive self-government, a social safety network that was really unparalleled in the ancient world. It was not strong on the participation of women, as we shall see, but there were ample roles for women to exercise power, particularly at the grassroots level, and especially in kind of disruptive activities, as we shall see. Let's look at how this structure worked. So first of all, the Kehillah usually coalesced around a group of leaders called the Tuvei Ha'ir, literally translated as the good people of the city. This number was typically seven. It was invariably only men, and typically wealthy men, who formed this cadre. They were put there by a quasi-democratic election where all Jewish males, sometimes property holders, but not exclusively, would vote for the Tuvei Ha'ir. Being a member of the Tuvei Ha'ir was, on the one hand, a great honor, and something that was to be pursued, but at the same time, it carried tremendous responsibilities, not only in terms of actually administering the Kehillah, but also in terms of expected financial contributions. It's a lot like the structure of modern synagogues today. They follow very similar patterns. If you're elected to the board of directors, that is a position of great honor, and you should be proud of yourself, but at the same time, there are expectations that you will support the synagogue with your wealth, not only with your energy. The Tuvayair would appoint a Parnas, who was literally the president. The word Parnas means a provider, and that might be the one who was perhaps the wealthiest among them, but he had the executive powers, and I can say he because these were all men. They would also hire a rabbi, and the rabbi wouldn't be in charge of a Beit Din or a court. Now, this is one of the interesting factors of the Kehillah that is replicated again in synagogue formalities. The rabbi is, on the one hand, an employee of the Tuvayair, and he can be dismissed. But on the other hand, you know, he represents rabbinic authority that undergirds all of this system. And so sometimes the Tuvayair and the rabbi are locked in a kind of a dynamic where the rabbi will exercise a check on the Tuvayair, and the Tuvayair, because they write his checks, they will exercise a sort of balancing against the rabbi as well. The rabbi tends to be the most charismatic and populist individual in Jewish leadership, but he is nevertheless dependent upon the Tuvayair for his financial well-being. And so the two groups tend to have a kind of a dynamic relationship between the two of them, which is not always cordial, but nevertheless stable. So under these groups, you have the Parnas and the rabbi both control Gabayim. This term gabai, that's a singular, is used in modern synagogues today, and it's sort of like what's sometimes translated as a beadle, which sounds a funny word. Basically, a synagogue functionary who chooses who is given what synagogue honors in the daily services and things like that. In modern parlance, the gabai seems to be a fairly low-level person, but in the Kehillah, gabai literally means a collector or an enforcer. And both the Tuvayir through the Parnas and the rabbi through the Beit Din could enforce their regulation. For example, if a person, you know, disagreed with his tax assessment, too bad, the Gabayim would come and they would collect it. If a person insisted on refusing to appear before the Beit Din, so the Gabayim would come out there, then they would arrest him, and they could actually impose corporal punishment upon him for repeatedly refusing to appear before the Beit Din. So they actually had real muscle, and this muscle was backed up by the king, because the king wanted the Jewish community to function effectively and to be able to hand over reliably the tax revenues that they generated by the various economic activities that the king had authorized, as we discussed in previous classes. So they had real power. It was a coercive organization in many ways. But here's the upside. The Parnas would set up a whole network of chevrot. A chevra basically means an association, a group of friends. The word chaver means friend or colleague or comrade in Hebrew. And the chevrot were essentially, you know, social service agencies that could serve a wide variety of purposes for the Kehillah. This is the amazing thing, that the Jews essentially set up their own localized municipal social service networks that represented a huge level of self-help that allowed the Jews, especially the poorer Jews, to rely on their community for support through difficult times. A few examples of the chevrot. Every community would have a chevra kadisha, literally the holy society. This was the most important of the chevras, and essentially this dealt with Jewish burial, the preparation of the dead for burial, the wrapping in shrouds and so on. This particular chevra was considered the most, you know, elevated of all of them, and belonging to the chevra kadisha was the greatest honor. It also represented a very difficult task of working with corpses to prepare them for burial, but it was considered something that was reserved for people of high dignity and authority, and it was considered very important. Below that, you would have, for example, a chevra shas, which would be a community which would be a committee dedicated to education, or the Chevra Bikur Cholim that would deal with health and visiting the sick and so on, the Chevra Tomche Shabbos, which would be a food bank. Sometimes these names would change from community to community, but all of them exist in, you know, well-organized Orthodox communities, to be sure, even to this day. The committee for Ozer Dalim, poor relief, for Haknasas Kala, the preparation of weddings for poor brides, Linat Tzedek for people who are traveling through, hospitality, Chevra Tehillim for purely religious purposes, like reading Psalms and so on. And all of these Chevras, you know, of course, it would vary from community to community, the density of the Chevras. Unlike the higher levels of Kehillah leadership, these tended to be dominated by women. Women tended to perform a high degree of the voluntaristic tasks associated with the supporting the community, and they would receive funds from the taxation that was executed by the Tuvair in order to make sure that their functions continued to progress. And with this remarkable social safety net, the Kehillah was able to survive. Now, it is important to note that there were a few options for appeal to the coercive nature of the Beit Din and the Tuvair that include, for example, sanctioned disruption of prayers, which was kind of built in and was something that could be used by women as well. That, you know, for example, during the daily prayers, if a woman felt that her claim had not been adequately addressed by the Tuvair or by the Beit Din, she could go show up in shul, could walk into the men's section, stand on the bima, and refuse to allow the services to continue until she received assurances that she would be heard. This, of course, was subject to a certain degree of abuse. It was a fairly extreme form of sanctioned disruption that nevertheless did allow many elements of society that did not have conventional power to be able to nevertheless make sure that their causes were heard. And by and large, this Kehillah structure really functioned very well right up until Napoleon basically destroyed it with the destruction of the corporate nature of Jewish society. A lot more to say about what that actually meant and how it fell apart in other countries like in Germany and in Russia. But even in today's American society, the Kehillah has a huge influence on admittedly voluntaristic organizations like in the modern synagogue. Okay, we'll have a lot more to say about the Jewish community, but for now, I hope you enjoyed watching this video. Thank you very much for watching.